Welcome to the editorial analysis of The Hindu. Today we will have a combined discussion for 2 days. There is a reason for me combining both these newspapers, which you will come to know shortly. So today the discussion will be for the 28th as well as for the 30th of September, 29th of September. It was Sunday and that is why there was no editorial. So the editorial for 28th and 30th is what I have combined. So come to the discussion. The first article, as a Z comes, a calling, a footprint without traction. This article somehow is important because this article can be linked to the context of India-Nepal relations. Basically, the context here is that China's president, Mr. Xi Jinping, it has a due visit in Nepal. This is going to be a historic and a landmark visit of a Chinese president coming to Nepal. And that is why this is what becomes important. This visit is what is due in the month of October. But still, nevertheless, we have an opportunity to discuss about India-Nepal relation and how China is a factor in the India-Nepal relation. So all of that is what has been discussed. So coming to the analysis. First and foremost, what has been talked here is about the Indian Prime Minister's visit. Now, basically, you should know that the Prime Minister of India visited Nepal back in the year 2014. And that in itself was what was a very, very historic visit, is what this has been talked about in the editorial. There was a shutdown in Kathmandu to welcome the Prime Minister himself. I'm sure many of you must have seen television footage or some pictures of him being circulated at that point of time. It was a landmark visit by the Prime Minister back then. And this is what gave a pause. Positive push to the India-Nepal relation. Thereafter, when there was an earthquake in Nepal, India was one amongst the first countries to help Nepal. India provided relief material to Nepal, so that was again a positive gesture by India. But despite these positive aspects, what has happened here is that there has also been a negative blockade by India on Nepal. And this blockade is what had resulted. This was an economic blockade that India imposed on Nepal. And this is what has pushed India-Nepal relationship in the downward spiral. This is what has alienated almost a whole generation of Nepalese. And that is what has been discussed in the editorial. So this is again something that is important. If you have an opportunity to discuss about India-Nepal relation, that is where you have to talk about this blockade that was imposed by India. This is something that is an important development in the India-Nepal relation. The nationalism in Nepal is almost of an anti-India sentiment, and that is one aspect that is very, very negative for both India as well as for Nepal. So that is important. Another important aspect is the Belt and Road Initiative. Now this is where Nepal is warming up with China. China has asserted that Nepal should make a shift from its India-locked policy. As of now, Nepal is a landlocked country, and that is why for all of its communication with the external world, it is dependent on India. And now China is offering another platform through the Belt and Road Initiative. So that is why Nepal is warming up to China. There are lobbies in Nepal of politicians who are favoring China over India. And that is one irritant that is developing. Another thing that is important here is vis-a-vis the partnership versus grants model. The partnership model is what Bangladesh has adopted. In Bangladesh, Bangladesh is not dependent on any country for any type of grant. It is rather welcoming investments in its area. And that is how Bangladesh is developing its international and geopolitical relations. Contrary to this, what is happening in Nepal is that Nepal is more dependent on grants, be it grants coming from India or for that matter China. So that is one model of development that is taking place in Nepal, and that is what has been discussed here, and that is also something that is important. Another important analysis is that despite the fact that both India and Nepal, India and China have committed almost $4 billion as grants to Nepal, there have been a slowdown in the processes of delivery of these projects for which grants have been given, and that is another written that is particularly important for India-Nepal relations. So that is important. Another important analysis in the entire article is in the context of the communist model. Now Nepal is also having a communist party that is very much active there, and communism is also the spirit and the political ideology of China. But what is important here is that communism in Nepal is very much different from the communism that is there in China. In China, the communism is what has originated in a very, very different from what was communism in India also. It is the West Bengal communist model that has been adopted in Nepal is what has been discussed, as compared to China, which has an entirely different model. Basically, in China, the communist model is all about hard work. It is how the society has to distribute work amongst itself so that the benefits of what can be shared by all. That is the communism model that is being followed in China, and that is not the model that India had adopted. Mao, for instance, has been very, very popular in India, and similarly, Maoism is what is popular in Nepal also. But clearly, Mao and his ideology is not the ideology that China is following. So that is one analysis that has been given in the context of communism. This is what has been deeply discussed in the editorial, but I personally feel that this kind of a question in the context of India-Nepal relation, or for that matter China factor, also will not be asked in much detail. You should only know that there are differences. It is not that both the countries have this one issue which can result in them uniting with each other. That is not the case. Communism is not a uniting factor for China and Nepal, and that is what you should clearly be able to identify. Rather, India's model of communism is much more closer to that of Nepal, and that is what is important. That is what you need to know. So that is the entire analysis in the context of this particular article. Indeed, the importance is in international relations aspect of the GS Mains paper, where India-Nepal relations are important. India's relation with all its neighbors are what are very, very important, including Nepal. So that is where the importance is. Coming to the next article, trust deficit. The context here is with regard to the Punjab and Maharashtra Cooperative Bank. Important development. The Punjab and Maharashtra Cooperative Bank is suffering a clampdown. It is suffering crisis. Basically, what had happened is that recently the RBI had come up with a regulation. It had notified that for few months only rupees 1000 could be withdrawn from the accounts of people who had their accounts in the PMC bank. It was for a time period of 6 months. So that is the basic context of this particular article. Later this was what was withdrawn, and the limit was what was increased to 10,000 rupees. Now, in the context of this clampdown, what you should know, that this particular bank, the Punjab and Maharashtra Cooperative Bank, is a 35-year-old bank. This is a long time period for this bank to have existed. This is also the largest urban cooperative bank in the country. Another thing that is important is that it has a footprint not only in Maharashtra, but it has a footprint in Delhi. It has its footprint in Goa, Gujarat, Karnataka. So this is a major bank, and for it to have faltered, it is something that is a matter of concern. Another thing that is important is that till now this was something that was not very much visible. This is what has come as a surprise to the investors in this particular bank. As per the annual reports of the banks, its deposits were growing by nearly 17% year on year to approximately 11,607 crore, is what has been talked about. So definitely the signs for the failure of the bank were what were not coming up. So this is something that has taken the entire banking sector by surprise, and already the banking sector is facing a crisis. So in that context, this becomes important. Another thing that is important is that this is what is a case, a classic case of government interference. Why is this a case of government interference? Because it is the RBI which has changed its previous decision. I told you that initially the RBI noted that it will only allow 1000 rupees of withdrawal for 6 months, but it has suddenly changed that to increase the limit to 10,000 rupees. Now, this is primarily in line with the fact that there are elections which are due in the state of Maharashtra, and maybe this was a decision by the RBI which was prompted by the government. Just in the last discussion, we have discussed about the independence of the RBI, and that is again somewhere where that is again an important topic, and it is there where this particular example can also be used, that yes, these episodes like these are hinting that RBI is not acting very, very in an independent manner, and there is government interference that is taking place. The third issue that is important is in the context of the HDIL. This is the Housing Development and Infrastructure Limited. Now, basically, this is a PSU, and what is important here is that in this particular context, there was a lot of loan that was given to the HDIL, despite the fact that the HDIL was not performing well. So it is primarily because of the irregularities of loans that were given to the HDIL that there has emerged such a heavy NPA on this particular bank, and ultimately resulting in this bank, a clampdown on this bank, and that is what has been discussed. Lastly, the analysis is general, which is important. A general analysis is always welcome. This is in the context of all the cooperative banks. Now, you should know that there are approximately more than 1500 cooperative banks in India, and a new roadmap is definitely needed for these banks, primarily because all the cooperative the banks are showing some degree of stress, so that is again something that is important. We have to understand that in the aftermath of demonetization, a lot of funds were what came to the banks, and as a result of which a lot of black money that was circulating in the system was what was absorbed. But the benefits of demonetization will not stand the test of time if banks will fail and drop like one after the other, and that is what the banking sector and the economy of the country for that matter cannot absorb as of now. So that is what is the entire analysis here. Indeed an important development. You should use this as an important example wherever an opportunity is there. So that is how you have to use this article. Coming to the next article, now basically it is for these articles that I had to club the discussion. Not only these two articles, one of these articles is from the newspaper of the 28th of September and the other one is from the newspaper of the 30th of September. Now basically, all of these articles that are coming repetitively are criticizing the government. They are extremely government bashing in their nature. It cannot be denied that what has taken place in the state of, for that matter now, the Union Territory of Jammu and Kashmir is smacking of some degree of government bullying. I have time and again mentioned that that is a case, and any rational person who is seeing this case will definitely be able to recognize it. The judiciary has not taken the matter seriously, rather the judiciary has not interfered in the context of preventive detentions that are taking place in the Union Territory of Jammu and Kashmir. There are a lot of rights of the people that are being eroded here. All of that is an issue, and I have discussed this in the past with you all. I have made a full video on Jammu and Kashmir. Please watch that video if you want information on this topic, because that is the kind of rational information that you can use in your paper. Now, Hindu newspaper, I am as of now observing, is really focusing on articles that are going very much against the government, and such kind of criticism, even if it might be acceptable to few, I cannot suggest that you should replicate it in your answers. This kind of a criticism will only make your views very, very negative, which UPSC will not welcome. So if you want to give them a read, you should give them a read. I wouldn't deny that. But I cannot quote these articles and the analysis that has been offered here in the context of anti-government framework. So from that point of view, I find these articles a little difficult and little distracting from your preparation. So if you can study the topic in a very, very rational way, it is good. You can give these articles a read. But if you are the kind of student who is unable to identify that this what is applicable for UPSC and what is not, my suggestion clearly is to avoid these kind of articles. They will only make you extremely negative in your approach, and this will reflect in your answers. So that is one reason because of which I have not included these articles in regular discussions, and because they were coming repeatedly, I wanted to club them together and convey my opinion on this. So that is what I personally feel. Rest, definitely you are the best judge for yourself, and I would suggest that if there are any other opinions that you also have, please share them with us in our comment section. So that's about these two articles, and that's about our discussion for these 2 days. I thank you all for watching the video.